Well, today is Friday, September 21st. My name is Priscilla Lee.
I'm Chelsea Lim.
Okay. And we're interviewing Dr. Lawrence Chan for the Houston Asian American Archive. Okay, so Dr. Chan, we'll first start out with where and when were you born?
Yeah, I was born in Hong Kong in 1942, within a month of the Japanese occupation of Hong Kong. Hong Kong's surrender to Japan on Christmas Day, 1941, and I was born within a month of that. So it was an interesting time, but I don't remember any of it.
And so what was your childhood like growing up?
So, as I mentioned in this chronology that I sent you, my family, several of us, I forgot how many of us, but not the whole family. Several of us, most of my family, went to Macau. Macau, as you know, is a peninsula about several hours by boat ride in those days from Hong Kong. And since Portuguese was not at war with Japan, so Macau was free. And they actually had open arms for refugees. And the Japanese did not stop us because it's better to have people leave than to have them cause trouble, you know, within the same colony. So we went to Macau and stayed there until the end of the war, until Japan occupied Hong Kong for 3 years and 8 months. So we came back sometime after that. And then, I was raised in Hong Kong, so apart from spending a few years in Japan.
So did you move from different neighborhoods in Hong Kong?
I make a few moves. My father was in the jewelry business. I used to live in the apartment on top of the jewelry store.
Oh, okay.
That was in Queen Street, Central. But then later on, we moved to Kennedy Row in Wan Chai area. And we were there, I guess, maybe 10 years or more. Then we eventually moved to Sassoon Row, which is close to Queen Mary Hospital. It's a little bit, out from the city, and lived in Sassoon Row until I, came to the United States. Mm. Oh.
So did you ever have to help out with the business, or no?
I didn't really have to help out with my father's business, but it's interesting living there because they have the people who were putting together the jewelry, putting together the rings, and they were doing the hammering and the melting, smelting, just on a different floor in the same house. So I knew the workers pretty well.
Oh, okay.
And they loved to show me, what they were doing. So it was sort of interesting.
Okay.
I was, probably too young to be involved in the sales aspect.
Yeah. Okay. So. Okay. So you were the youngest of a total of six children?
Yeah, a total of six children. I was the youngest.
Mm-hmm.
My oldest brother is the oldest. We're about 10 years apart.
Mm-hmm.
So, in between the two of us, there are four other people. So my oldest one, my brother, and then there are three girls, and then two boys, and I am the youngest.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
my brother is now, my brother now lives in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
My two brothers live in Canada. My oldest sister lived in Canada. She passed away about a year ago. And my another sister still lives in Canada. And one of my sisters, who used to live in Canada, moved back to Hong Kong. So she's now in Hong Kong.
Oh.
So right now, there are five of us. One passed away. I guess four in Canada, and I'm in the States. Well, actually three in Canada, I'm in the States, one in Hong Kong right now.
Mm-hmm. closest to any particular sibling?
Well, since I'm a lot younger than my oldest brother, mm-hmm. I'm not that close to him. So I'll be, you know, fairly close to the brothers and sisters who are, you know, closer in age to me. But I think, you know, it was a happy family. My oldest brother went to the same high school I went to. So it's called Wayan. And he was a hard worker. So whenever my father taught me, he said, look at your brother. Try to do things like what he did. You know, he works very hard. So, okay?
Okay.
Yeah.
So how was...
I think I told you it was a medical family,
yes,
right? I mentioned that, yeah. Because my two brothers are doctors too.
Mm-hmm.
And of my three sisters, two of them were nurses and the other one used to work in a pharmacy. So it was a medical family.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the influence, you know, came from my paternal uncle, number three, who got his medical degree in Lingnan, which is a Chinese university. Then he was trained afterwards in Canada. Then he came back to Hong Kong and was in private practice, and he was doing very well. So he had a lot of influence mm-hmm. on the next generation.
Just like, did you ever talk to him about the medical field or just him being a doctor?
Just him being a doctor. Okay. We talked a little bit, but, mm-hmm. You know, not that much. But he's a, you know, he's a great guy. Everybody liked him. That's why he was successful.
Okay.
You know, his personality.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how he was as a doctor, but mm-hmm. he was very popular. He was, you know, a lot of patients.
Oh, okay. I see. And so where did you go for primary and secondary school?
Okay. I went to a few schools in, you know, when I was really young, and, mm-hmm. you know, up to about, well, I think I started with about fifth and sixth grade. In Hong Kong, it's called primary five, primary six.
Mm-hmm.
And that was when I got into Kaoyan. Kaoyan, at that time it was Kaoyan College, but they do have great schools there. Then there are five, what we call forms. Those are, you know, I guess secondary school.
Mm-hmm.
So I went through forms one and two in Kaoyan. And I tried to get into Wayan. I tried after form one, I didn't get in. I took the entrance exam. I couldn't get into Wayan College. But then after form two, I took the exam again because Wayan was a pretty famous top school in Hong Kong. It's a Jesuit school.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't have formal entrance exam,
mm-hmm.
but when you know people, so you got a recommendation letter from, you know, big shots,
mm-hmm.
you get to take the exam if they don't accept you. So the second time I took it, I was accepted into Form 3.
Okay.
So I left Kaoyan. The Chinese name is different. The yen is not the same yen, but I put down the Chinese name there. Yeah. So I got into Wayan and stayed there. So it was form 3, form 4, form 5. And form 5 is an important year because that's the end of secondary school.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a public examination at the end of that. The whole, you know, all the schools participate in that. There are two types of exam. Two types of schools in Hong Kong in those days. I think they may still be similar now. English school and Chinese school. And I went, Wayan is an Irish Jesuit English school. So the subjects were taught in English, although we also had Chinese. We had Chinese history, you know, some subjects in Chinese.
Mm-hmm.
But the other topic, the medium of the other subjects was English. So, you know, we learn English that way. And of course, when it's recess, we all speak Chinese. And, you know, people will say, oh, it's not snobbish, why do you want to speak English? So they, you know, we didn't want to. There were one or two who wanted to show off.
Oh.
Otherwise, you know, nobody liked that.
Mm-hmm.
And talking about that, in Khao Yan, I didn't mention in my write-up to you, I think primary 5 and 6 were very important to me. That's when I learned English in some depth, because I learned English and grammar. I think I probably knew ABCD, things like that before then, but I learned grammar. The grammar in Hong Kong, the teacher was very good, was a, you know, I forgot her name, a woman teacher. She taught me all, you know, the 8 parts of speech and everything. It's interesting, I think people in the States may not realize it, some of the best grammarians are Indians. Indians are very logical. So the textbooks we use were from India. They were, in fact, most schools use that textbook. The author is called Ren, W-R-E-N, but he's an Indian guy. Everything is so logical. So I think that was actually pretty important, because I believe I had very good basic understanding. I would say the people who learned it, on average, they were better than some of the students here. When I went to, you know, when I went to Canada, mm-hmm. I think my history and physical was better than the Canadians, because they were pretty sloppy. Mm-hmm. Mine was maybe a little bit more, you know, less colloquial, maybe they put something colloquial. Mm-hmm. So I was just used to the strict, you know, grammarian type of English. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
So what did your mom do as a career?
Well, my mom was a full-time mom, so okay. At home. Mm-hmm. And in those days, they were very good in, you know, taking care of the home with, you know, very good in cooking. Mm-hmm. She knew some English, which is very unusual. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, she died very young. Mm-hmm. She died when I was only 12 years old. Yeah. So I think she was pretty smart. She had, I think, colon cancer, and she passed away very young. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So who took care, what did your father?
Well, I was already 12.
You're 12.
So I was okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what kind of cultural traditions were celebrated?
Well, it's all Chinese, you know, Cantonese. Mm-hmm. I mean, we celebrate, you know, all the holidays that mm-hmm. the Chinese celebrate. You know, Chinese New Year is a big deal. Mm-hmm. I think now it's not as big even there, but Chinese New Year we had 2 weeks of holiday. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the Chinese, yeah, until after, you go back to school after the 15th of the Chinese, you know, January, mm-hmm. the first month, you know, because, you know, the tradition, it's 15th is the day of man, of mankind. Mm-hmm. And then each of the other days, the day of a particular animal.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the 12th.
Yeah.
And then, after, so you went to the same high school as your brother at Wayan?
Oh, no. My oldest brother.
Your oldest brother.
Yeah.
Okay.
The other brother was just, you know, old, was only 2 years older than me. The, mm-hmm. the one who was next to me just, he went to a different school.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. You know, I guess he couldn't get in Wayan, mm-hmm. unfortunately. Mm-hmm. We were in the same class.
Okay.
I sort of felt bad because I was the younger when I got in.
Okay.
Yeah, he couldn't get in. Oh. And actually, I got into University of Hong Kong.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so after Form 5, I took the school. It's called School Certificate Examination. And that one is a colony-wide examination. And as I said, there are two tracks, English track and Chinese track.
Mm-hmm.
And I took the English track examination, and I guess I did well because I was awarded a Grantham Scholarship.
Mm-hmm.
Alexander Grantham was the governor of Hong Kong right after the Japanese, you know, left Hong Kong. So he, there was a huge growth and all that. So it was named after him. And I actually started Googling, you know, the scholarship. It still exists, but it's totally different. It's for something else now. So there is still a Grantham scholarship. But in my days, they awarded it to the top 20 of, you know, all the graduates for that year. Mm-hmm. In those days, it was about 8,000.
Okay.
Yeah.
That
was, I think, Grantham scholarship for 2 years. Not much money, but, you know, it's the honor, I guess.
Yeah.
I believe there were two in my class.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Pretty competitive.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I had one guy who was very smart.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there was another guy.
Yeah.
It was, YN is a boys' school.
Boys' school.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Did you have a favorite class or a favorite teacher?
Well, I think the teachers are generally okay, pretty mm-hmm. good there. Because there were some priests who were teachers.
Yes.
Some of them outstanding, some of them are not so good, just like us.
Yeah.
So I think the English was okay, was good. The history was good. We actually, in Form 5, in Form 4 we had geography, but there was no geography in Form 5, so I didn't take geography as, you know, you have some choice.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't take geography. The whole class didn't take geography. There was no geography teacher for Form 5.
Mm-hmm.
But very strong in the arts. It was okay in the sciences, but probably overall very strong in the arts. I took science class afterwards because to get into medicine, you know, you need science.
Mm-hmm.
You need, well, there are two levels. The system is lower six, upper six, you know, Form 5 and then Form lower six, upper six. And lower six, we had to take both science and humanities, you know, English and Chinese and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So that was lower six. And then upper six, then we have to take advanced level, which I took just physics, chemistry, and biology. Yeah, so I took those and I got distinction in chemistry. So, you know, after 2 years, you take that, and with those exams, then it determines whether you're accepted into University of Hong Kong or not. And that actually was the last year that University of Hong Kong, okay, requirement is you pass physics, chemistry, and biology advanced level to get into the medical school. There are other schools, you know, there's a science school, then that one you can get in without passing all three. But I passed all three so I could get into medical school. But that was the last year, because it was getting more and more difficult. The reason is my brother, he took the same exam as I did. You know, it was, again, I felt bad. He flung one of them. I forgot which one he flung. You know, I don't remember whether it was biology or chemistry or whatever. So he had only two. So he couldn't get into medical school then. So he retook it. He repeated that class. And he got a few more subjects. And he passed. Normally, in the past, he could have gotten into University of Hong Kong Medical School. But because of the increased number of students, he couldn't get in. Even after he repeated 1 year to qualify, because he fulfilled the minimum qualifications. So he went to McGill instead.
Mm.
He went to McGill. So Hong Kong system is the British system. So you get into university from the two intermediate classes, you know, lower six, upper six, whereas Canada is the US system. So he got into a bachelor's degree, I think he took biochemistry or something at McGill.
Mm-hmm.
Then he got into medical school, you know, in McGill too, after he got his bachelor's in biochemistry.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a different system.
Yeah.
So I felt bad for him, but on the other hand, if you look at his degree in the US, if you don't know people will probably prefer his because he's from McGill. You know, Hong Kong U, nobody heard of him. Although, you know, Hong Kong U was actually tougher than McGill. And Hong Kong U was, had a very good reputation in Hong Kong. Yeah, because, you know, I guess we all felt, we thought it was the greatest school in the world. That's what people thought. I can give you an example. My my daughter is married to a actually Chinese Korean born in the States, and his father, so my daughter's father-in-law, was from Hong Kong and Guangzhou, you know, from this from the city. And when he heard that we are from University of Hong Kong, it's better than Harvard, you know, because it was difficult to get in and it was supposed to be very, very good. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he, I don't think he went to college, but it's well known. Yeah. So that also is another reason I was hoping I could get in, because I mentioned, you know, in what I sent you, I was accepted into MIT, but then, you know, why waste money for my family? So I decided to, you know, just stay around and hopefully I would get into University of Hong Kong. So I was lucky to get in.
So what was that like? What was those years at University of Hong Kong like? Or Hong Kong University?
It was pretty intense. It's a 5-year thing. So I think that's the way things will run in the UK. The first 2 years are preclinical. So you take, you know, all the, you know, you take biochemistry, physiology, et cetera, pathology, you know, first 2 years. And then there is a major exam called second MB. You better pass that. Otherwise, you know, you can go on. You can repeat, I think. But you have to pass that in order to get into your clinical years. So the last 3 years are clinical, you know, clinically oriented years. So it's a total of 5 years. That's the British system. And but we didn't need a bachelor's degree to get in. You know, we need the advanced level, which is sort of in between, probably slightly below bachelor's. Yeah, yeah, but no degree.
So what was your experience like treating patients, and did you like medicine?
Oh yeah, I did pretty well. I think in my CV, if you look at it,
yes,
I actually was. I got number one in pediatrics, so I did okay. They give it distinction, they call. But I was number one, I was the only distinction, actually, for that class. And then I also got distinction in medicine, and there were two distinctions in the class. I think I may not be the number one, I forgot. But anyway, there were two distinctions. So I stayed, and I was, I took my internship in Queen Mary, which was there are a number of teaching hospitals, but Queen Mary is the top one. Mm-hmm. You know, people get distinction, more or less, they reserve space for them. So I was there for 6 months to do medicine, 6 months to do surgery. That's the system. Then I went to London, Ontario, Canada. Mm-hmm. Went to University of Western Ontario. Because I was very interested in academic medicine. So I knew I wanted to go into research while I would keep on practicing, you know, treating patients. So research in Hong Kong, University of Hong Kong, is, you know, limited. They don't have enough funds and things like that in Hong Kong in those days. Some of the teachers were very good. As I said, some of them went through Washington U. So they for their, I guess, postgraduate training. So they knew it was a good school. But I had to get into the North American system first, I thought. So I applied to a few schools in Canada. It was Canada was a reasonable choice because it's a British, you know, Commonwealth. And I was from a British colony. So everything is pretty familiar. Although the mayor system was different. In Canada, it's the American system. They also are the same because they have MDs. They don't have MBBS. You know, in the UK, it was MBBS. So I did a rotating internship. I was accepted to a few schools. But London, Ontario was among the ones that were pretty south, mm-hmm. because it's cold in Canada. So I went there and I saw my first snow in my life, so that was interesting. It was a good school. I learned a lot, and it's very, very interesting because, you know, I'm sort of reserved individual. So in Hong Kong, in those days, you know, people are more reserved, and I was more reserved among the reserved people. So, for example, at rounds, you know, what we call rounds is the professor, you know, seeing a patient and doing some explanation. You know, I was the type who wouldn't speak up until I was asked. There were one or two who would speak up a lot, and some of them are not that good. But in Hong Kong, they knew, they more or less take turns and ask. And, you know, in Canada, again, I kept my tradition. I didn't really say too much. So you could say, you know, they could have missed me. But fortunately, whenever the resident who was senior to me couldn't answer the question, they asked me and I knew the answer. So I think I impressed them. Mm-hmm. It's important to get, you know, I mentioned recommendation from a school in North America. If we want to get to another school in North America, you can probably get into a good school without that, but I think if your recommendation is in part from a school there, because people didn't know much about, you know, Hong Kong U. So I got into essentially all the schools I applied to. Mm-hmm. I applied to the three best hospitals in Toronto, Montreal, and Vancouver. I got in all three. Then I got in multiple places in the United States because I think I needed some. Well, and they also saw that I did my internship in Canada. I think that helped a little bit.
Okay. Did you have any culture shocks when you came to Canada?
Not bad. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think my English was okay, so mm-hmm. I understood everything. So it, culture shock in that it was just. You know, I think London, Ontario was the fourth or fifth largest city. It was like a tiny village to me.
Yeah.
At that time, it was 100,000. I think that was London, Ontario. And, you know, Hong Kong at that time. I purposely look up the population of Hong mm-hmm. Kong in different times, yeah. just to show the contrast. Because mm-hmm. you want me to compare Houston and Hong Kong. Mm-hmm. It's very different in the sense that Hong Kong is so crowded.
Yeah. So you went to London, Ontario to do your residency?
My internship.
Internship.
Yeah, I did that just to be safe. It turned out that it was probably not necessary, but it's okay. You know. I enjoyed it, had a good time. And also, I guess, get a little bit even more used to the American to the North American system.
Yeah.
So then, I probably would speak up a little bit more after I came here.
Yeah. So what did you do afterwards?
So I went to St. Louis, Washington University. Okay. It turned out to be a really good school. It's a top school. In those days, it was probably ranked number 4 in the country. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So at my residency in internal medicine. So I did, we were called junior assistant resident and senior assistant resident, you know, in medicine. So we took care of patients and, conferences and things like that. No research, you know, for 2 years. There may be some people who do some research, but I never did any research during that year. Okay. It's difficult, you know, it's busy. You may participate in some, you know, minor research, but no research during those 2 years. Okay. So after my senior assistant resident, I decided to that I like to do academic medicine. So I just went across the street to the biochemistry department, talked to the chairman there, said I wanted to do 2 years of biochemistry. He was very happy because the chairman was actually an MD. Roy Vegeros is pretty well known. He said, you're welcome to come to my lab, but you're also welcome to talk to, you know, I give you a few names of a few professors. So I talked to Louis Glaser, who was a professor, PhD, and I thought he was, he seemed like a nice guy, very good. So I joined his lab and spent 2 years in his lab.
And why did you choose to go into academic medicine?
I think I always had some interest.
You just, okay.
Yeah, even from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I look at my professors, I wanted to be one of them. I wanted to be one of them, so.
That's what happened. 2 years of research.
In 2 years of biochemistry. It was called postdoc.
Postdoc, okay.
Yeah, postdoctoral fellows. Oh. So I did 2 years, and Louis Glaser, he was a very nice boss.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, that was when he also, it was at the time, let me see. Yeah, later on, he also wrote letters for me for my immigration.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I was there for 2 years. So I had some research experience. I gained some research experience. That's one of the things that's a little bit weak in Hong Kong, because the research, you know, was not as well developed as in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
So I decided at that time to go into endocrinology. Yeah, endocrinology, metabolism. So I look around the country and decided to. Well, it's interesting actually. I picked two places. I picked Harvard, Massachusetts General Hospital, which is probably the top hospital, most well-known hospital, academic type of hospital in the United States, because they in the New England Journal they always have case studies at the Massachusetts General. So I applied there, and I applied to Vanderbilt, because Vanderbilt is well known for endocrinology. So Mass General, Harvard, pay me for an interview. So I flew from St. Louis, I was in St. Louis then, to Boston. On the way, I stopped by Nashville, and I interviewed at Nashville, at Vanderbilt. And the chief of medicine was a very well-known endocrinologist. So the chief of medicine had lunch with me and, you know, talked me into joining Vanderbilt. In those days, at least. When you finish your residency in a, you know, pretty good place, and then you have 2 years of biochemistry, you know, that means you're committed. So I think I was a good candidate in that sense. So he spent an hour and a half with me and had lunch together, and then he had a fellow, you know, one of his research fellows take me around to look at different places. So I met with some scientists I wanted to work with. There was one scientist there who was very well known, you probably heard of cyclic AMP. He was the one who really did tremendous amount of work on cyclic AMP. That was the beginning, you know, as a, you know, signaling type of molecule and things. So I talked to him in his lab. He didn't do lab himself, but he had an assistant who was very good, talked to him. And then I also heard about another guy who was in a different department. The cyclic AMP guy's name was Earl Sutherland, very well known. So there was another guy who was there that I didn't know whether he would be interested in, you know, interviewing me, and I asked, and they said, okay, he'll be happy to talk to you. So I interviewed with Bert O'Malley, who was new there, who went there maybe 2 to 3 years ago. He was more junior, he was very young, very impressive because he was young. So I talked to him, he said he'll be happy to take me. Okay, so I spent a whole, you know, about 5 hours at Vanderbilt. Then I took the connecting flight to Boston. And I stay at one of the faculty's home, an assistant professor there. And they were very nice to me. Then the next morning, I was going to go to Mass General to meet the big shot, a very well-known guy by the name of John Potts, who was very well-known in bone metabolism. You know, world expert. It's a little bit like the Vanderbilt chief. He was a world expert on his, in his area. So I went there, and he was not in his office. So I spent time sitting there playing with my fingers. And then actually it was sort of interesting. There was an old elderly woman whose name was Anne Forbes. She was in her 80s. She took pity on me. She said, oh, come here, let me talk to you. So I talked to her. She's fascinating. There's a syndrome named after her, Forbes Aubrey syndrome. So she's well known, but she's in her 80s. She's very dynamic, so I was very impressed with her. And then, the fellow also told me around, talked to various people. And finally, the boss came back and talked to me. So I compare, you know, both well-known guy, Mass General, you know, Harvard, great. And Vanderbilt, the chairman of medicine, had lunch with me. He treated me well with respect. This guy, you know, I had a great time with Anne Forbes, but not with him. I mean, when he came back, eventually, you know, he missed his appointment. He didn't come until much later. I talked to him, and he was, you know, he would sell his place and things like that. I'm sure it was a good program, but mainly because of the way I was treated. I said, okay, Vanderbilt. So that's why I went in Vanderbilt. So you never know what happens. Oh. And actually, Harvard paid for my trip. Mm-hmm. I just stopped by Vanderbilt. Okay, so I went home, and then I decided to go to Vanderbilt. So that was July, I guess, 1972. I finished my residency in St. Louis, in Washington, U, and my biochemistry, and then went to Vanderbilt.
With Bernal Mallon?
And then, yes. Well, it's an interesting story. I got there on a Friday, and as usual, Bernal Mallon was out of town. So my wife and I went out and rented a house. It was sort of duplex, and then bought a refrigerator, whatever, and then moved in. And then on morning of Monday, he came back and I talked to him. He said, we're moving. So I said, wait, what? Yeah. Anyway, he was being recruited by Baylor. So he essentially said he's moving here. So, I talked to the boss at Vanderbilt. He said, well, try to talk him to stay. But it didn't work. He decided to leave. And to me, the research was important. So I decided to move to Baylor. Although at that time, Baylor, really, there was only one endocrinologist. So it was a very minor program. But I decided to move here anyway. And then at that time, they also recruited a new endocrine chief. It came a few months after I did. So there was a chief. But I was, so I moved in. And I worked with Dr. O'Malley in his lab for a few years. And I joined the faculty in medicine and Bert O'Malley's department. That's how I ended up in Houston.
And just stayed with Bert O'Malley?
For a few years.
Okay.
Yeah.
How was the demographics of your lab?
Well, when I was staying in his lab, then it's his lab. So mm-hmm. I was a sort of a instructor, mm-hmm. which is a glorified postdoc instructor for about, actually for a year. I was lucky. They promoted me pretty fast. Mm-hmm. So I became an assistant professor and stay on. I published a couple of papers with him, and then you know, the rest is about my research career, which is mm-hmm. sort of interesting, a different topic, you know, in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Because there was when it was in the midst of my immigration crisis.
Okay. Yeah.
Because I started it when I was in Vanderbilt, and I had to continue on doing it, you know, in Baylor, in Houston.
Mm-hmm.
So the people I knew in Washington, you would write letters for me, and Bert O'Malley would write letters, and other people would write letters. And
mm-hmm.
I told you the American Heart would write letters,
mm-hmm.
and I couldn't have. I wrote an NIH grant, I got it, but somebody else was the PI.
Yeah.
So you know, it was very, very, you know, restrictive. So I decided that I got to get immigration. So I got it, I guess, you know, so went through all that and got the bill signed by Jimmy Cucati in 1977. I moved to Baylor in 73, so it took 4 years. So during those 4 years, you know, I had to be working under other people in a way, although I got the grant. But, you know, he was reasonable at the end. You know, the grant was probably for 5 years. At the end of that, he said, you know, you take it with you for the renewal. Yeah, so I applied for renewal and under my own name then. So that was. And also, American Heart did help me because they gave me a grant. In addition to American Heart grant, there's one called Established Investigatorship. That's a grant. There's a salary grant. So I was an established investigator for 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the fellow investigators was actually a Nobel laureate. Mm-hmm. So during those times, I did mostly cardiovascular stuff because my research led me there. You know, I mm-hmm. went wherever my research went. So you see a lot of my, you know, awards and things like that. American Heart, a lot of them.
Yeah.
I this big prize mm-hmm. was cardiovascular related.
So I
did well in that area. After some 20 years, I decided to gradually go back to more endocrinology and diabetes because I went to meetings, and a lot of them were heart meetings. I gave, you know, lectures there, and you know, cardiologists, you make a lot more money. And my wife's an endocrinologist, so I didn't make that much money, although I was, you know, presenting more papers than mm-hmm. they did. So I said, well, I better try to work back into the endocrine area. So I started doing things in diabetes. I mean, luckily, you know, everything I did, I was lucky. I had good people working for me, and I, you know, immediately published some high-profile papers in endocrinology as well, in diabetes especially, and pancreatic islets and things like that. And got back in the, you know, go to meetings. I'm not as rich as the cardiologist, so it's good. Go back to my time.
Mm-hmm. Were other people in your lab also of like Asian descent, and like were you ever treated differently, do you think, because of your race?
I must say I didn't really feel it. You know, I didn't feel that. I think possibly, yes. Mm-hmm. But I'm an optimist, I always, you know, fairly confident, and I can tell you an experience I have with another assistant professor. I was asked to write a chapter in a book, I actually have the chapter here. So I thought, oh, maybe, you know, he's in the same department, he's a PhD, I asked him to write it with me. So I wrote my part, asked him to write his part, and then I put it together. His English is outrageous.
Mm-hmm.
He went to high school, college. He's an American. He's Caucasian.
Mm-hmm.
I rewrote the whole thing for him. He did talk to me afterwards. He admitted. He said, "Oh, your English is much better than mine."
Mm-hmm.
So.
Sorry, it's up a little.
Are we?
Okay, yes,
thank you.
Sorry.
Okay, so I, So I guess that's overlapping my immigration at that time. So finally I got my immigration in 1977, got the bill passed in Congress, and could start having my own grants.
Were you ever like...
And the other, I guess, oh yeah, some of these things are later, so I looked at the chronology. So what happened?
Oh, I was going to ask, were you ever going to, like, scared that you maybe couldn't stay in the U.S. and that you'd have to go back to Hong Kong, or were you...
Oh, I was worried. I was worried, you know, I guess I'm, you know, I'm optimistic, but I was worried. And my wife is a real worrier. In fact, I was lucky she was a worrier. I worry, you know, I clam up and, you know, just worried to myself. She talked to everybody. She's very outgoing. She talked to everybody, to our neighbors and to everybody she met. That's how I got to know Lama Alexander. So thanks to her, you know, I would, you know, not really worry that much, which is bad actually, because it was a very serious situation.
So what were some challenges that you faced doing research in the beginning, and then as you kept going?
Well, I think the main thing is I didn't have immigration, so my grant generating ability was, you know, constrained by the fact that I couldn't be a PI, principal investigator, couldn't be my own boss for a few years, except for the American Heart Grant, which they somehow liked my grant and they waived my requirement. I told them, of course I told them, you know, I apply for permanent residence. And eventually they wrote a letter for me, actually. So that was nice.
So their main challenge was immigration.
Yeah, that was my major challenge.
To get funding and everything. Yeah.
Well, funding, yeah, funding, I was fairly lucky. I was, in those days, funding was a lot better. I think those were probably the golden days of research. Because in those days, NIH would fund roughly 20 to 25%. Nowadays, it's 10 to maybe 13, 14%. When you get funding 1 in 10 out of 100 people, you can really look at a grant. You know, I was a reviewer for, you know, for many years. Number 8 is the same as number 12 out of 100. You can tell. So, you know, it's impossible to, no matter how good you are, to guarantee you'll get it funded. But if you can get it 1 in 4, then maybe you shouldn't be funded. You know, it's very different. 1 in 10 and 1 in 4 is totally different. So, you know, nowadays, I think it's better the last year too. But for a period of 15 to 20 years, you know, the funding level was 10 to 15%. It's very, I think, too low. I think at least 20%. You know, it's reasonable. You know, 2 out of 10 is not easy, but it's okay. You know, you can compete. 1 out of 10 is just crazy, I think.
So how would they differentiate between proposals?
Well, reviewers.
Reviewers,
You know, I mean, we're all human, so we all have our biases. So that's why it's so erratic. Because the psychology is very, your psychology is different when you know the funding is low. You look at this, okay, you can say, oh, I don't like this. I mean, it's good, but if 1 in 10 should get funding, this guy shouldn't be funded. So let me give him 15 to make sure he doesn't get funded. If I like this guy, I like his science, I like it. Let me give him a 5. You tend to, you know, push outside. So you get, you know, you want to kick out the ones you don't like, mm-hmm. and then try to make sure the ones you like get funded. Uh-huh. That's bad. But in the old days, when funding is 25%, then, you know, you let the chips fall, because you don't know whether it's going to be 22 or 27. And of course, you know the ones that are really bad. The ones that are average won't get funded, but the ones that are pretty good, they have a chance. So I think that's the psychology. So when funding is bad, it's a little bit erratic.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So did you have any mentors in the research field that you wanted to talk about?
Mentors? Mentors? Well, I guess Bert O'Malley was my mentor in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And then, but I, you know, watch other people. He's run a very successful lab. But I learn a lot from being around his people, because he's good, so the people who work for him are good. So the conferences, some very smart people would speak up and I would listen. You know, I'm not smart, but I learn from them. So I keep learning. So that's good. I guess, in the old days it's good. Because for many years I was lucky, because I could get funding. So my lab, for probably a period of maybe 25, 30 years period, probably vary from at least 10 or 12 people to some 20 people. So they are good people.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, they helped me, you know, publish a lot and things like that. So I was lucky. You know, occasionally you get some bad ones. I'm lucky. I haven't had too many really bad ones.
Mm-hmm. Did you want to talk about how your lab was affected by Tropical Storm Allison in 2001?
Yeah, that was a long story. the Tropical Storm was in the region. It's interesting. It's not even a hurricane, it's tropical storm. And the flooding eventually was not like Harvey. The flooding was localized in a very small region around the medical center and a few miles. So what happened was heavy rain on a Friday. I think it was June, I think I put down the date. All day, very heavy, pouring down. That was what, 2001, yeah. I mentioned that at that time I had a lab in the basement, a big lab, two big rooms in the basement, around April or May in the year 2001. And then had a renovation, very nice renovation. They spent maybe a month or so renovating the lab. Beautiful lab at the end. And, Museum of Natural Science interviewed me during that time in the beautiful lab. So that was nice. Then on June 8th was Friday, heavy rain all day. And then, on the 9th, a Saturday, I always go back on Saturdays. I went back to Baylor and I could hear water flowing, and Baylor was black, very dark inside. No power. So I walked toward my lab and I could hear water flowing in different parts. And my lab was in the basement. So I looked in the basement. I saw that there was, maybe 6 inches of water. So I waded in water, and on the wall, it's not 6 inches. You can see the water line. It's probably about 4 feet of water during the night. So everything was destroyed. And huge number of mice were destroyed because they were mostly in the basement. They were either drowned or even the ones that were drowned, actually you couldn't use them because they were in the dark. They had no light, they had no feed. Anyway, and people had to wade in to save the mice, some of the mice that were on the top levels. And I lost well over 3,000 mice. University of Texas, I lost more than the whole university across the street because my lab was big. I think I was number two user in terms of size. I think Bill O'Malley was number one. I don't know how many lost. I might have lost more than he did. So I essentially lost everything.
Mm-hmm.
So the lab people, came back, etc. So we had about 18 people or so, something like that. So it's interesting, as I said, I'm sort of a calm guy, maybe not sensitive enough. I feel bad, but not that bad. I felt, got to start again. So as I said here, all the people stay with me. There was one new postdoc who started only a few weeks before. He left because he couldn't take the stress. But he was new. So I said we should keep moving. So I had my lab meeting here in this room.
Oh.
Once a week. In fact, we didn't have a lot to talk about, but I wanted to keep their spirits up because we couldn't do experiments. We couldn't do experiments for a few months. But I had to keep the spirits up for everybody, and we had to do some planning. And as I said, I had one technician who was very good, who kept track of everything. He did the estimate what was lost, etc. And at the end, we discovered we lost more than $3 million worth of stuff, which really didn't take into account a lot of other things. Lost productivity, things you can count. So at the end, it's probably a lot more than that. So we didn't have a lab, but people were nice. People offered me lab space. Even in University of Texas, I had friends there. I said, you want to send a couple of people? You're welcome to. So actually, a couple of people worked there, only for a short while, for actually maybe a week or two. We decided to change things. So. And finally, after a few weeks, somebody in an unflooded part of Baylor was the Huffington Center for Aging. So the chief was a good friend, Roy Smith. He said, we have some space. As I said, he thought I had three or four people. He didn't realize he had to find room for some 20 people. But even if I were, he said, we'll work it out for you. So I moved there temporarily, but the temporarily was more than 2 years, I think.
Oh.
So we moved there. I moved to a new office and just started everything. Had to start from the beginning. We essentially lost our mice. We lost our rabbits. The rabbits were not killed. I think most of them were rescued. They rescued them. But in the confusion, the rabbits were valuable because those were very rare rabbits, because they were what we call transgenic rabbits. Transgenic mice are, I wouldn't say a time it doesn't, but they are pretty common, but it takes time. But transgenic rabbits were very rare because it's much more difficult to produce. And we had them. But they were mixed up. So when I tried to do experiments, what I thought was a transgenic, we did the check, the DNA was not. So we got rid of all of them. So we lost all of them. So in terms of animal, it took us a long time to rebound. And of course, some of the projects that were ongoing, it was easier to just cancel them or forget it. You do from the beginning, it takes you another 5 years. So we started moving to you know, maybe some alternative experiments, alternative things. I actually wrote to the NIH, you know, told them what happened. They actually gave me some money. So I got some extra money. I don't remember how much. Not the whole grant. They gave me maybe, you know, 50,000, whatever number, I forgot what it was. Because I was the head of the program project. A program project means you have three or four projects by other PIs. The other PIs' labs were not flooded. NIH gave them the same amount of money. I was the PI. So you each get, say, a proportion of what you have. So they benefited tremendously. No, I could have said, my lab is destroyed, so I take it off, but no. And I said, you know, this is for you, so I just distributed it as though everybody was flooded. So there was some help. So that, so the whole thing probably, you know, was a setback that lasted quite a few years, but, you know, we got through it. It was not a major problem. It's a little bit, it's an interesting experience. Because, for example, I was hit the worst in Baylor. When I was walking around, whenever I saw somebody who knew me a little bit, he said, you came on scene, oh, I'm sorry. He said, why are you sorry? I don't feel that bad. So, but they knew that, you know, I lost everything. So they kept on saying, I'm sorry. I didn't feel as bad as they, you know, thought I felt okay. I guess it's my temperament. So Baylor was very supportive. So actually, during the flood, after the flood, they have a war room, okay? Put down, how do you put things back together? So one time, maybe after 2 weeks or something like that, the chief administrator, you know, let me into the war room. On top of the war room, chalk, you know, they put down how do you, you know, divide up stuff and do, what do you do, what a plan. Top, Larry Chan, : whatever he asks. I didn't ask for much, but that was very impressive. So I was very happy.
So did it great, Jim? You just went to other alternatives on your research path?
Oh yeah, you know, I could do, you know, I could change some of the experiments and things like that. But that was, you know, that was okay. That was pretty simple.
Okay.
You know, that was, you know, when you're used to it, it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's why I didn't really worry too much about that. You know, I worry, but no use worrying, so I just went on.
Okay. So you've traveled throughout the country as well as the world to give lectures and talks and stuff, and you said you had pretty unique experiences then.
Yeah, yeah, it's really interesting because some of the places I went to, I probably wouldn't have gone there, you know, if it was not an invitation. You know, I mentioned some of them. For example, I went to in Europe, what did I say, close to Sarajevo.
Interesting people.
Yeah. Oh, well, for example, I was invited to go to Riyadh.
Mm-hmm.
And originally my wife wanted to go with me. So, and after a while we decided, oh, you know, I should just go alone. And I was, because she would go with me in unusual places. So I thought that they were unusual. It turned out that it was good that she didn't go. Because if you're a woman, you go there, you're treated like trash. It's very, very harsh if you're a woman. You know, you've got to cover up before you go out. And, you know, when you're walking around, five times a day? Well, anyway, when the mosque sings out something, you have to stop and pray. If you don't, they'll beat you up. They have the morality police, they'll beat you up. You know. So, of course, I didn't walk around that much. Apparently, when you drive, it's okay. You don't have to stop driving. And then, even if she came, she wouldn't be able to go to... If we go to a restaurant, she wouldn't be able to go with us. Because in a restaurant, the women go to the back. It's a different room.
What country was this?
Riyadh. That's the capital of Saudi Arabia.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Yeah. I mean, it's an interesting experience for me because I went to the, walked around a little bit, actually took some picture. When I took a picture, there was a girl with her mother. She screamed. Apparently, they were taught if you're in a picture, you lose your soul, you steal her soul. So she screamed. Her mother knew, just took her away. And it's interesting going through security. So, they search me and go through and all that. But when a woman cover up everything, they just wave and she can walk. They don't search her. So it can be a man. A man can just dress like that and walk through. So it's a very, very interesting. So. Yeah, the other place I went to, let me see, I sent you an email, I forgot. Oh, let me, yeah, it's here. Yeah, Slovenia. Ljubljana. It's interesting because I probably would never visit that country if I were not invited. It's a very small country. My wife and I went together. We spent about 4 or 5 hours. We took a taxi and visited the country, the mountains. The reason it's interesting was World War One. Is it World One? Yeah. We started there. Yes. And beautiful trees, valley, and scenery beautiful. The beautiful scenery hides about a million people who have killed there. It was the first place where poison gas was used. So, people just die. And it's, as you know, you cannot control it. The wind may blow the other direction. So I visited. It's beautiful, but they have museums. And when you stop by a museum in a beautiful place, you kind of, around here. 600,000 people die on this part, and then so places like that, and like we are in this place. Mm-hmm. So you go to places that you normally don't go to. In addition to some of the other nice scenic places, I went to Japan a lot because I trained a lot of Japanese. Mm-hmm. Lots of Japanese. In fact, I don't know what they. I train, if you include summer students, I train probably over 30 Japanese. Because they actually send me summer students, only for the summer. But even without those, I probably train, it must be more than 30. I must have, include those probably 40, 50 people. Because in the summer, some students would come and spend several weeks in my lab. I set up a formal agreement between it was Shiga University and Baylor. Because I trained so many of them, the postdocs, and decided they wanted to send the students. Okay. So I've been to Japan probably 20 times. And my wife loves it. Collected Japanese stuff. You see some of you see the kimono, doll.
Oh, yes.
You assemble it yourself. Yeah, it comes away in a kit.
So. Nice. So how are you involved in other aspects of the research community? Did you want to talk about, like, you mentioned how you organized diabetes?
Yeah, I think probably I highlighted the diabetes story because it was interesting. Because I was, diabetes the community in Houston was sort of in the background, not too much was done. I think until I became the because I don't know my official title. I was president of something, of the local chapter. It was a big chapter of, you know, Southwestern. And because it was also partly because it was a very good administrator, his name is Ralston something. So I organized, so that's one thing. And then we have diabetes walks, you know. You can stay. So we would, you know, make up things like that, you know, every year. And people would join me and my lab group plus my section, the diabetes center, and some other Baylor people. And this is different. I got this when I gave a talk at DSU.
Yes.
So, you know, we participate in activities like that. So that's part of, you know, being the president of that for a few years. And then even after I was not, we got involved. So every year we do that. And then I also have diabetes. We call Diabetes Day over at Baylor. So we would invite a lot of people and I would give lecture, you know, at the level of the people, you know, about diabetes, diabetic complications, things like that. And people would come, you know, some of the, for example, Dr. Chow's family came once to that and also get with the ADA, local ADA, they would sponsor sort of schools. They have, I call them ambassadors or whatever. So those are all actually women, you know, young women who would support diabetes, but they were themselves became celebrities, you know, that big dinners and things like that. So a lot of activity related to diabetes because I, you know, we have it. Since I got the diabetes center to Baylor, and then there was a big sign there. I guess I didn't bring it. There was a big sign that says Diabetes Endocrinology Research Center on the wall, on my floor. Yeah. So I think these are activities that I introduced to Baylor and to the community. So there were a lot of things like that at that time for about probably 15 years, something like that, yeah.
So how would you define success in research?
Define success in research? I guess it's a very difficult definition.
Yeah,
because you know, do you define it by how much money you generate? I think theoretically, I think it's very hard to pick. There are different ways to define it. I think that's different ways you look at research. I think probably important discoveries is probably the most, to me, that would be the most important part. Obviously, when you look at, people look at anybody with a researcher, they always say, oh, no, he's well-funded, usually he's good to win that game. But I think, you know, yeah, that's also true. That's in general. But I think, you know, there are some people who got a Nobel Prize who only published two or three papers that were worth Nobel Prize, but that's it. That's good enough. You know, you don't have to publish, you know, hundreds of papers. It's not necessary. So it really depends on how you define it. I think, you know, some discoveries are more important than others.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So it's hard to define. I think if you just look at funding, I mean, generally they go hand in hand to some extent, but some of the best research were not necessarily by researchers who were well funded.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what do you think attributed to your success?
Well, I guess a bit lucky. I had good people working for me.
Mm-hmm.
I think I get, people work hard, but people who work with me, they get along. So my lab group, they get along very well.
Mm-hmm.
And I have Christmas parties here since I became chief. We invite about 60 people. So, well, actually, I have two parties here. One is really for the faculty and others related to Baylor faculty, and then another one is my lab. My lab is maybe about 30 people, but here for the other one is 40, 50 people. It's my wife does all that. She's she's a perfectionist. She's very excited when she does that, but she's also very worried. Oh. So she works hard on that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So how did you meet your wife?
I think I was her younger brother's godfather. I went to, Jesuit school. She went to a Mary Knoll sister's school. And her younger brother was in YM.
Mm-hmm.
So I was his godfather. His younger brother is now a big professor at MIT, actually. He's a PhD there. He's head of the Lincoln Lab. Anyway, he's a big shot. Let me see, there was something else I was thinking. So, my wife is, I think, very talented. She was a teacher. She taught geography. We travel quite a bit now. And she studies up, but even she's so committed when she travels, she knows the destination place better than the locals. She would talk to them, shouldn't we take bus number 7 instead of number 4? And she was right. Something like that. So she's, very, very good. She also happened to be playing the equivalent of the World Cup in badminton 3 times.
Wow.
In Hong Kong when she was a teenager.
Okay.
Yeah. So she represented Hong Kong 3 times in the... It's not called a World Cup, it's called a Uber Cup. Uber Cup is badminton. It's a little bit... Thomas Club is tennis. Okay. Uber Cup. Uber. Okay. Yeah.
So what year did you marry?
We got married in, I think it was in there, after we went to Canada.
Okay.
1967. Mm. Yeah.
And I read in the bio that she gave up her job to
go. Oh, yeah. I went to London, Ontario. So she also applied to University of Toronto because she, she has a bachelor's degree in geography. And she actually has a diploma, in Hong Kong we call it diploma education, so she was a well-qualified teacher. She taught, senior high for a very short time in Hong Kong. She taught the top school too. At that time, my school was top school, the school she taught was top school. Now we are talking about, say, 40 years later, her school remains number one, my school has gone down a lot. Well, the reason is my school changed policy, but they decided to change. Mine was a Jesuit school. Hers was a Episcopal, anyway, Protestants. But it's not really the religion. It's the philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
The Jesuits, at least probably about 10 years ago for my school, they had a choice of either turning down government subsidy and charge more in tuition. If you take government subsidy, which they decided to do, not because they need the money, because their philosophy was to teach the masses. If you take subsidy, you're committed to taking students sent to you from the government at a certain level. So you cannot be as selective. Whereas the school she went to turned that down. You know, it's causing Paul's co-educational college. And that was her, the school she taught in is number one in Hong Kong. Has been number one for a number of years. It's crazy. They could have entrance examination, thousands of people who line up for one position. You know, it's crazy. So my school is, because the, you know, we graduates, I didn't participate, but many pushed our school to turn down subsidy. So they might change policy, because we used to be top. Mm-hmm. It was a very good school for general education, because we were fairly independent. The Jesuits gave us a lot of independence. So, I mean, you know, Hong Kong, we Chinese, we used to, you know, force freedom. Not much freedom, but the Jesuits treated us, you know, with respect, I guess, mm-hmm. in those days. Now there are very few Jesuits, very few priests. So the people had, in general, had leadership mm-hmm. in those days. For example, government officials, the leaders, the governor, many of them were from Wayan College. Yeah, so it's common, it's one of the most common sources, you know, of leadership. Mm-hmm. But now, I think some of the old boys, you know, from Wayan, they voted to turn down government subsidies so that they can, their reputation could go up, back up again. So that's what happened.
Mm-hmm. So when you're doing research, how is like your work-life balance? And I read that your two children were born in St. Louis.
Right.
And you were doing your research.
Right.
So how was that like?
Well, I must say, my kids have done well. They would have been totally neglected kids without my wife. She took over everything because she was a teacher, so she's, you know, she was after them. Mm-hmm. She was sort of a tiger mom. Okay. So, but you know, she did well. I would say if I were the one to take care of them, I'm not so sure they would have done what they are doing. They're both doctors now. They're both physicians.
Jumping around, but what characteristics do you think a good scientist should have?
Well, I think it's important to be honest. Mm-hmm. So integrity is important. And then a sense of discovery, like new things, and mm-hmm. you know, like to go for new things.
If you had to choose again, would you have chosen medicine and then going into research like you did, or?
It's hard to say, probably. In my days, you know, we just used to study and things like that, so probably would be like that. But nowadays, I probably, you know, I would have been more free, I guess, nowadays to pick what I want. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if I were born again and do something maybe, I don't mind going into music or other things, you know, mm-hmm. or paint. I used to draw very well. I always, you know, was the best drawer in my class. Mm-hmm. And then I did a little bit of painting, but now I haven't done it for a long time. So I think I would be more free. Mm-hmm. But I was, you know, somehow very constrained when, because of, you know, the time I was born and the mm-hmm. environment. Okay.
And then at home, do you
right now speak Cantonese or? We speak
Cantonese. Okay. Yeah.
So I'm Chinese to other Chinese, and I'm Chinese Americans to non-Chinese.
Okay, I see.
I'm comfortable as Chinese American, but mm-hmm. I'm also very comfortable as Chinese. I guess Chinese in the sense of Cantonese.
Mm-hmm.
There's a subtle difference, as yeah. you know, slightly different mm-hmm. dialect. My wife is, you know, Cantonese. She's good in Mandarin. My Mandarin's terrible. You know, I go to Taiwan. I was on the committee for about 10 years. Taiwan was trying to start an institute like the NIH.
Mm-hmm.
They call it National Health Research Institute, NHRI. And I was among a batch of about maybe 30 to 40 Chinese who were active in research in the West, I guess. So majority from the States, maybe a couple from Canada, maybe a couple from the UK. They invited them back to Taiwan. That's in the early 1990s, started then. So I went back every year. And because my Mandarin was bad, for NHRI, the official language was actually English, so I could get by. But when you're a whole bunch of Chinese who speak Mandarin, when you get together, even if the official language is English, they started speaking Mandarin to each other. And because my Mandarin is awful, I misunderstand them and I don't understand what they're saying often. So it's... I know a little bit, but sometimes I know enough Mandarin to get into trouble. That's the problem.
So did you want to talk about the Jun Da Yong symposium?
I think you probably had never heard of her before.
Yeah.
She's a very, very nice lady. It was interesting. She was very active. Let me see, I have something. This is her obituary. She was born here. She was the crown princess of the state of Oregon. I think, you know, some sort of, I don't know whether it's beauty or talent or whatever. And then travel with the royal court across the United States and Cuba, you know. And then she's so nice, she started the Jun Da Leung Symposium to get together all the Chinese doctors in Houston to meet, to exchange ideas,
mm-hmm.
and to, she paid for everything. We meet at a restaurant. Once a month. So it's called Jun Da Leung Symposium. So that's how we interact. That's how I got to meet all these people. And she's very sweet. It's interesting. Yeah, she was born in Oregon, I think. But I looked it up. Yeah, she passed away, you know, about some time ago. So I think, especially old doctors like me,
mm-hmm.
We're grateful to her because I met a lot of, you know, more senior doctors because this symposium stopped maybe 10 years ago or maybe a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because she was getting up in age. But it was, she did a lot for the Chinese doctors in Houston. You know, now there is a club kata, Chinese Association of Doctors in Houston or whatever, CADAH, Chinese American Doctors of Houston or whatever. But she did that before there was Carter. In fact, the Carter was started by somebody junior to me, who probably even went to the symposium later on. So she was very important for the Chinese doctors, I think, for the early generation.
So how have you seen like the Houston, I guess, Asian American science field change over the years?
Well, it's changed a lot since the rise of China, right? Now, when I first came, there were very few Chinese, and there may be a few from Taiwan, and very few from Hong Kong, you know, but now it's 90% from China, you know, some from Taiwan, very few from Hong Kong nowadays. So things have changed a lot, yeah, in terms of where they are from. But now there is, you know, Kata, as I said, so people belong, some people belong to that for doctors. And then if you look at the professors in Baylor, MD Anderson, you know, different University of Texas, there are more and more Chinese professors, MD Anderson especially, quite a few professors. Most of them, I think, are from mainland China, a few from Taiwan. I think with time, people like you will gradually, you know, take over, local born, but still quite a few from China. Yeah. Because China only opened up probably since the late 80s and early 90s. And then I guess in the last 20 years it's gone, you know, a lot of people. It's changed a lot.
Did you, over the course of your career and research, did you ever want to go back to practicing medicine?
Remember, I still practice.
Oh, you still practice? Okay.
You know, okay. When I was chief of endocrinology.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Yeah, yeah. So I was.
So you still practice?
I practice in Bentop. Oh, supervisory. Okay. I more or less, you know, see patient. I see the wealthiest few and the poorest. The wealthiest, you know, at one time, for example, you know, Dr. Chow's brothers came and talked to me about their father.
Okay.
So those are the wealthiest. And, but I also see the patients at Bentop who can't afford to pay. So I don't see people in between that much.
Oh, okay.
But I see patients at Bentop mainly to teach.
Oh, okay.
It's teaching.
Teaching.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah.
So how many hours, how would your week go? Like,
well, I think I pick months. I only do it several months, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some months, things like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did you have any questions, Chelsea?
Do you have any advice for students like us, maybe, who want to go into medicine?
Well, go after your dream. Just push out for what you want to do. I think you'll do well. Rice is good university, so.
And would you mind telling your story about immigration again, so you can get it on?
Okay, sure. So, yeah, I can talk about the immigration story. Did I summarize it somewhere? I think I did. Very briefly, but I can I did talk about that. Okay. So I was at Vanderbilt when I applied for immigration, and that was at the advice of Vanderbilt, you know, because Hong Kong was a peculiar situation. They didn't know that. So when we found out that it was not straightforward. That's when, you know, we met Dr. Lamar Alexander. So, and found out that there is no, you know, no, actually no option other than a new law that will allow me to become a permanent resident. I might bring up that, you know, Lamar Alexander was not an immigration lawyer, which was actually, you know, it was wonderful that what he did for me. If it were an immigration lawyer, my wife's name would have been in the bill. Because they would not say, oh, we won't pass it because his wife is not. No, you always keep, you know, couples together. So it would still pass. But then he's not an immigration lawyer. So he didn't know the intricacies. But he worked hard. He's very nice. You know, I was very impressed with him. He actually ran for president. He didn't get too many votes. So he tried, you know. He maybe got 1 or 2%, very, very low, pretty early. And he's nice in the sense that he's really sincere. He didn't charge us that much. You know, I don't remember exactly how much it was. But my wife thought maybe a couple thousand. I thought it was only a few hundred. Anyway, very minimal for what he did and what was accomplished. Because he was in Washington. I first found out he met the head of immigration. But of course, I understand that he actually worked in the White House before. So it was not that hard for him, but at least he had to do it. And the other thing I want to share with you is the fact that he's a very empathetic guy. You know, Maria, my wife, is a worrier. There were times when we call him at home and he would talk to us on the phone. You know, we were here because we were worried for half an hour. He did not send us a bill. So that was very, very exceptional. So he was, I think I told you he invited us to his inauguration.
Mm-hmm.
You know, unfortunately we didn't go. And then subsequently, you know, I listed his positions. So he became governor and then became president of University of Tennessee, Secretary of Education, and then became Secretary of Education in George Bush, H.W. Bush, and now senator for the last, well, since 2002. So he's been senator of Tennessee for a long time. So he's a great guy. You know. I included his inauguration invitation. So that was an experience, and as I said, I learned a lot because, you know, the senators, I watched them on TV because it was days of Watergate. You know, that's the important committee, and I learned how a bill works. Because you got to have two bills, one in the Senate, one in the House. So at the end, you know, they passed. It took a long time because we didn't push. Because people thought that, oh, you know, he just wants to stay in this country. And I just, and I said, I can't survive here, you know, doing academic. If I don't have a permanent residency, I cannot apply for grants. So that's what happened. So it was nice that he did all that for me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And you also said Barbara Jordan was also very nice in helping you.
She was very nice. I saw her, but I didn't meet her. I met with her aides.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. She's a very. She was in the. Watergate committee too.
Mm-hmm.
Many of them are. I think the Judiciary Committee.
Mm-hmm.
And she spoke like she's a booming voice and a very beautiful accent.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, amazing, very amazing. Yeah. She's well known for that, apparently.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think the whole family is very, very well educated.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think she unfortunately died pretty, maybe in her early 60s or something, because she died pretty early.
Okay. I guess turning now towards like your present life, and do you have any hobbies and like side interests that you're pursuing? I understand like you retired in 2016.
Right. I retired in 2016, in July 2016. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So my wife and I traveled a little bit more. Mm-hmm. You know, went to various places. And we can also visit our kids a little bit more. But I can visit them a whole lot more. The reason is, nowadays, I mean, you can tell me, they are so busy. There are so many activities. You know, when they were kids, you know, okay, my son had soccer, my daughter had piano, you know, very few things. Now, they every night they're busy, you know, with their kids. Yeah, I don't know why. Yeah, for both of them, my son's kids and my daughter's kids. Mm-hmm. So they are so busy. So the world has changed, I think, is too. Uh-huh. So they should relax a little bit more.
Oh. Are they in Texas?
Or? No, that's the problem.
Oh, okay.
My daughter lives in Saratoga. Mm. That's close to San Jose, you know, California.
Oh, California.
Yeah. My son lives in Andover. That's in Massachusetts. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, a few days ago they had, you saw the news, the gas lines burst and houses that had explosions, and all over Andover, North Andover and Lawrence. Mm-hmm. That was in the news, national news, for a few days. Mm-hmm. Houses were destroyed. One guy was killed because of, you know, uncontrolled gas pressure, I think. I don't know what happened.
You mentioned that you wanted to start picking up art and ping pong again.
Yeah, I'm doing some ping pong now.
Okay.
Nice. I wanted, as I said, when I was young, I was pretty good at drawing. Mm-hmm. And I did a little bit of painting when I was in St. Louis. I took some painting lesson and did some painting. I seemed to be okay. I did pretty well, but then I haven't done it for a long time. So I might do it, or might pick up singing. I don't know.
Okay.
I have a low voice, but maybe it's good for singing. I don't know.
Yeah. So what would you consider your greatest accomplishments so far in life?
Oh. I don't know. I think I've done fairly well. Both at work and in my family. I think I'm proud of my two kids. They're doing well. They both graduated from college. Both became doctors, and they each have three kids.
Oh. Yeah. Did you put pressure on them to do medicine, or?
Okay, in terms of getting them to work hard first,
okay.
That was to give credit to my wife. Okay, because all their success is all caused by her. You know, I think if I were the only one, I don't think they would have accomplished what they have accomplished. That's the main thing. So let me see. What was the question again? I was answering part of it. Wrongly.
Greatest accomplishments, and then I asked, did you push him into medicine, or like
yes and no. My two kids, they both did okay and got into medical school and all that. The difference was my older daughter. She's very smart. She went to Baylor, you know. She and then went to Harvard. She could do anything, and she would do pretty well. You know, she played piano very well, etc. So in college, I think what we suggested to her she was a good writer. She wanted to write and things like that. We strongly suggested her to have a profession and then do whatever she wants once she has a profession. So she became a doctor. My son wanted to be a doctor anyway, so so that's why she became a doctor. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, she may be a poor writer. I don't know. Yeah, she's still, you know, she's smart. She has hobbies. She, you know, makes pottery, and then she used to have a website that talk about how to handle problems with kids, with children. Mm-hmm. She's not a pediatrician. She's an adult. She's in, so she has a disclaimer at the end saying that, you know, see your pediatrician. Mm-hmm. And she also has a website. She works at Santa Clara Valley Medical Center. Mm-hmm. She has a website updating topics in medicine. She updates it, and it's subscribed. You know, you get to the site by subscription. And, you know, even UCSF would go there and subscribe to it. So so she's the only one who, she started the website, she maintains it, etc. She's very modest. So she puts down the names of all her colleagues. I mean, she's included in there, but she's the only one who's working on it. So she likes to do things like that.